which aims at enabling anonymous authentication. So there are many applications for this, which are e-voting, electronic cash, and anonymous authentication. And in order to build this this so-called privacy-preserving cryptography, we need two main basic tools, basic building blocks, which are a signature scheme and also zero-knowledge proof, which should be compatible with the signature scheme, which should allow us to prove statements about this signature scheme. And later on, we'll focus on group signatures. So what is that? I will motivate it with an example, so the public transportation example. So we have a user who wants to commute, and to do this, he will ask the stamp machine a challenge, which is, for instance, a timestamp, which he will sign. And by doing this, he will authenticate himself. But in fact, he doesn't want to authenticate himself, but just to prove that he possesses a valid subscription for the public transportation system, which means that he wants to stay anonymous in the set of users who possesses a valid subscription. So he also wants some anonymity property. And on top of that, we have the public transportation company who wants also some properties like dynamicity, which would allow new users to rejoin, to subscribe for a subscription at any time dynamically. And at last but not least, we also want traceability, which means that in case of a user misbehave, an authority, for instance the police, should be able to lift anonymity of a given signature and trace back a user who misbehaved. And we will focus mainly on the dynamic setting, so which is an improvement of the static setting, a more powerful primitive, and it allows us to add new users to the group without having to rerun a setup phase. It also enables like powerful security properties, because no one can impersonate you, even the authorities if they collude. And finally, we saw, like with our example, that most use cases will require dynamic groups, because beforehand we don't know the size of the group, who will be in the group, the size of the group, and also the group can evolve with time, so it can grow and grows with time. And now we'll move on a very similar primitive, which is called anonymous credential, which basically enables the same functionalities as group signature, which is anonymous authentication. But here the anonymity is non-revocable. It's unconditional, because here a user can authenticate himself, but will stay anonymous in any cases. And why I tell you about this primitive is that because to construct this, we have a general construction based on the signature with efficient protocols we construct in the we construct here in this paper. And so what is this? So signature with efficient protocols are basically a signature scheme. And with efficient protocols, so first of these protocols is a protocol to sign a message on a committed value. And also another protocol should allow us to prove knowledge of a valid message signature pair for this signature. And what we can notice here is that this signature is, so all the existing construction are based on strong RSA or bilinear maps. So in order to not put all eggs in the same basket, we want to build this primitive in the lattice setting. So what is it? So basically, a lattice is the integer linear span of some finite set of independent vectors. And what is interesting here is that a hard problem on this is to find a non-zero short vector in the lattice. And we'll basically rely on this because it's conceptually simple and asymptotically efficient. It's also still conjecture resistant to the existence of a quantum adversary. And we also have nice security property for cryptography. For instance, we have a connection between average case lattice problems and worst case lattice problem. So it's kind of nice. And before going further, we will I'll just show you an overview of the history of our hardness assumption, our security proofs relies on two intractability assumptions, which are small integer solution, which basically is finding a solution in the solution of some homogeneous linear systems. And this solution should be small and integer, which makes it hard. And also the well-known learning with errors, which in its decisional version will is basically distinguish this distribution from the uniform. And so now a quick overview of the group signature history. So it has been introduced in 1991 by Schaum and Van Aist. And we have to wait until 2000 before having the first scalable and secure solution from Athenis and others. And in fact, since the introduction by Schaum and Van Aist, there were many different security definitions, which has been unified in 2003 by Bellara, Michensho, and Varinsky, who proposed a model that implies all these previous security notions. For the dynamic settings, in fact, we have 1 year later, Skyasen Jung and Bellara Shizong proposed at the same time two different models, which are equivalent up to some details. And for the lattice setting, we see that we have first construction is from 2010, so 10 years after the first construction by Athenis and others based on other assumptions. And this scheme has some problem is that the signature size is linear will grow linearly with number of users, which is non-desirable. And in 2014, we have the first log-sized signature from lattices. And these two schemes are for static groups. So for now, until this work, there are no dynamic group signature scheme based on lattices, and we aim at filling this gap. Okay, so now I will go further into details. Like I will motivate more the our schemes, and then I will show our constructions. Okay, so as I said, with to enable anonymous credential, we need it is implied by signature reception protocols, and so it's basically a signature scheme. We have a keygen, sign, and verify algorithm, and with this we have two companion protocols, which is for assigning a committed value and proof possession of a signature. And the security notions, which goes along with this, are unforgeability, because it's a signature scheme. We have the security of these two protocols, and also anonymity, because it's a privacy-based primitives. And from this primitive, we have many applications from privacy-based cryptography, as we saw before. And also, we saw that all the construction rely on a strong RSI assumption and or bilinear maps. So this is why we want to build it from lattices. Also, from dynamic group signatures, it's more formally, it's a tuple of five algorithm. We have the setup algorithm, which will take as input a security parameter and an upper bound on the group size, which is important here in order to construct the different parameters, like the public parameters. And it also outputs two secret key, so one for the group manager and one for the opening authority. We have the join protocol, which is an interactive protocol between a user and the group manager, at the end of which the user will get some public membership certificate, which will attest for some secrets he will be the only one to know. We also have sign and verify algorithm, which will act as in standard signature, except that the verify algorithm will take as input the group public key, because users don't have any public key. And also the open algorithm, which, given the secret of the opening authority and the signature, will output the identity of the user who signed this signature, hopefully. And so for security, the security notion that goes along with this protocol are, first of all, anonymity, which states that without the secret of the opening authority, no one can lift anonymity of a given signature. We also have traceability, which is a security of the authorities against users who want to escape from traceability. So no user can forge a signature on behalf of another user, or a signature that won't open to a valid user. So that won't open. And I can notice that these two notions are the notions that are given in the static setting, because in fact in the dynamic setting, as there is no in the static setting, there is no dynamic join, so we don't need the dual of this, which is the security of honest members against Again, these NIST authorities want to frame them. And which is the last security notion we have, is non-frameability, and it's introduced by the dynamic setting. Okay, so now we'll move on the construction, how we build these two primitives. So first of all, the signature scheme with efficient protocols. So to build a signature scheme, we'll rely on a signature scheme based, which was introduced by Boyan in 2010. And which is a small integral solution based signature, because we can see that the signature here is a small integral solution for some linear equation. And the thing is that given a short basis for this lattice, for this this matrix, we are able to compute a signature for a small integral solution, and without it, it's a hard problem. And in fact, we want work directly on this one, but from a variant due to Bull and others, which is a tag-based signature. We have here a tag which is a random string. And we moved the message from inside the coefficient of the system to the non-homogeneous term. And why we do this, so we'll see it right now. So to construct our signature reception protocol, we first compute this random tag as I presented before. And we'll then generate a short vector S, which will be used to compute this this commitment. It's a, so this is a commitment scheme due to Kawashi and others, and we built it like this because we saw that for signature with efficient protocols, we need one protocol to sign on a committed value. So we embed this commitment inside the signature. And we embed it in this manner, so we can see that we use the binary representation of the commitment instead of the commitment itself, because the second protocol, companion protocol we want for our signature scheme is to prove the knowledge of a valid message signature pair. And to do this, we'll use a Sternax protocol, which requires that the coefficient of this this vector are small. So binary is basically small. And so this is how we do this. So as I said, we already embedded a commitment scheme in our signature. So we can basically make sign committed value by signing directly this commitment. But when we are trying to do the proof, we notice that we have one problem is that one of the signature queries won't have the same distribution as the others. Actually, the center of the Gaussian won't be exactly the same. So we cannot use directly an indistinguishability argument to make the proof. So how do we overcome this difficulty? We use a technique due to Bai and others in EjaCube last year, which is basically using a Rennie divergence instead of the statistical distance to bound the adversary's advantage. So to do this, we use a nice property of Rennie divergence, which is called the probability preservation, which will allow us to bound the probability of this event with respect to the Rennie divergence of the two distributions. So with that, we managed to prove the security of our signature scheme while finding a committed value. And now the next step is to prove knowledge of a valid message signature pair. And to do this, we'll use the Stern protocol, which was introduced in 93. And so what is it? So it is a zero knowledge proof for syndrome decoding problem, which is as follows. So we have it's somewhat similar to inhomogeneous small integral solution, except that instead of having a small vector here, we have a vector of a fixed Hamming weight here, and it's also binary. So it has so there are many extensions on this protocol which has been proposed. So the first one by Kawashi and others, who managed to go from modulo 2 to modulo q. But they still have this constraint on Hamming weight, so we don't have exactly the lattice languages that we want. And Ling and others in 2014 proposed extend this in order to leverage this constraint. And they go to prove SAS and LW statements. And since last year, we have many protocols that uses this Sternax signature, like the one Kua presented yesterday, or last year. And problem with this is that for most of this, for some of this scheme, they will build a standard protocol from scratch. And in order to avoid it, we propose a framework to deal with this. So it allows us to construct a zero knowledge argument of knowledge of linear modular equation of this form. And thanks to linearity of lattice statements, many of these statements will fit in this setting. We can reduce them to this form. And moreover, as we can prove some special property on this equation, we can also capture more complex statements. And to do this, we use Ling and others decomposition extension framework and do it in a combinatorial manner as standard protocols. Okay, so then we have our signature scheme extension protocols, and we'll use this scheme to construct our group signature. So how do we do it? We build it from a static group signature due to Ling and others, Ling and Green and Wang. And the main problem we want to go over is provide non-frameability. And to do this, we need to introduce a non-homogeneous term in order to avoid a user to tamper with its membership certificate to escape from traceability. And the problem is that we use this scheme because other solutions that has been proposed use membership certificates made of a complete basis, which will basically give to the to a dishonest user too much freedom. And so it won't interact well with this non-homogeneous term. So to sum up, so we have many difficulties we want to overcome. So we first want to separate the secrets between the opening authority and the group manager, because in the static setting there is no group manager at all. We also want to give the user a membership certificate, so we want to bind actually some secret of the users to some public value, which here will be a syndrome, so the multiplication of secret vector and public matrix. And to do this, we'll use our signature scheme with efficient protocol to embed this inside our signature. And also, we want to achieve non-frameability while not compromising the previous security notion we had from the static setting, so namely the anonymity and traceability. Okay, so now how do we do this? So we first generate the public parameters, which are this matrix and vector which came from our signature scheme with efficient protocols. And what's interesting is how we managed to do the join algorithm, which is a new algorithm in the dynamic setting. So first of all, the user will compute a short vector, in a short integer vector, and compute this public syndrome. Then send this public syndrome to the group manager. We will sign it using our signature scheme with efficient protocols. And actually, we see that the tag of the signature scheme will be seen as the user identity, and which will be the membership certificate, which will be sent back to the user, who will just verify that it's indeed a valid signature for this syndrome, and then save it as its membership certificate. Okay. So now we can notice that the join algorithm consists of only two messages, one in each direction, which makes it round optimal, and also that there is no proof knowledge that is exchanged here, so which allows concurrent join. And so now we want to build the signature scheme. So we want full anonymity, which means that we want anonymity even in presence of an opening oracle. And to do this, we basically use the construction from Bellaresh-Tizong, which will use the CCA PKE. And to construct the CCA PKE, we'll use a Canetti LVCAT transformation on an IBE. Actually, it will be the Gentry Packet and Vakutanaten IBE. We'll construct our CCA PKE on. And how we do this? So we will first encrypt the public public syndrome of, which is assigned to the to some users. So the user will do this, and then we'll prove that the underlying VI indeed verifies this the signature equation, and that it's a correct encryption. And the message here is bound to this inside this proof of knowledge through the Kiat-Shamir transformation. Okay. So now to verify, we just have to check that this proof of knowledge is correct. And to open, the opening authority will just decrypt this this ciphertext. We'll get the public syndrome and just check in the records if which is I which corresponds to this VI. And that's it. So to conclude, we managed to provide the first, sorry, to sum up, we managed to provide the first lattice-based signature reception protocol, which we believe to be of an independent interest of its own, because, yeah. So it allows us to obtain signature on a committed committed message and proving possession of a valid message signature pair. Using a simplified version of the signature scheme with reception protocol, we construct our first dynamic group signatures based on lattice assumptions, which has some nice properties, like it's round optimal and enables concurrent joins. And we can see that this this join can be seen as a method for signing public key, so that we can efficiently prove the knowledge of the underlying secret key. And at last but not least, we provide a unified framework to prove modular linear equations using Stern combinatorial techniques. And we managed to overcome the difficulty of combining Bell and other signature with Ling and other zero-knowledge proofs to provide our signature with efficient protocols. So thank you all for your attention. And if you have any questions, I'll be glad to answer them.
Is there any question? A short question? Okay, all right, there is no question. Let's thank the speaker again.